So we'll move on to our next panel, which is the Frontiers of Autoimmune Research. And it's being led by none other than Dr. Noel Rose. A little about Dr. Rose for those who aren't familiar, although it's hard to believe because he is called the father of autoimmunity. Noel Rose is one of the world's leading authorities on autoimmunity and autoimmune diseases. It was his pioneering research 50 years ago that laid the foundation for autoimmune disease to become its own category of diseases today. An immunologist, pathologist, and molecular microbiologist, Dr. Rose founded and provided nearly two decades of leadership to the Center of Autoimmune Disease Research at Johns Hopkins University, Bloomberg School of Public Health. During that time, he served as professor and chair of the Department of Immunology and Infectious Diseases. Dr. Rose retired recently, moved to Boston, joins Brigham and Women's Hospital, Harvard Medical School as a senior lecturer. Along with Virginia and Jerry Ladd, and of course, Dr. Stanley Finger, he was right there from the beginning when ARDA was founded. He served as ARDA's Scientific Advisory Board Chair in 1992 and has been on the board ever since, first as a member and then, as I mentioned, as chair and now chairman emeritus. Dr. Rose is also author of the classic textbook, The Autoimmune Diseases, the recipient of numerous awards, and author of more than 760 peer-reviewed journal articles. And he's here with us today. We are honored always to have Dr. Rose when he comes to visit us. So please help me welcome Dr. Rose.
We have the easiest job of any panel that you've heard during this remarkable meeting, because we simply need to forecast the future of autoimmune disease research. So we've assembled a panel of intrepid explorers of the future, all of whom look at the elephant we call research in autoimmune disease from different points of view. And we're going to meld our thoughts to try to give you some idea of what may be the topic of a similar panel 25 years on. To introduce my fellow panelists, we have Dr. Ben Larman from the Department of Pathology at Johns Hopkins Hospital, Dr. Mark Zielinski from the Veterans Administration and Harvard Medical School, and Dr. Bill Eaton from the Department of Mental Health at the Bloomberg School of Public Health at Johns Hopkins. We've heard a great deal about the problems of the present with respect to autoimmune disease. We heard a panel that discussed ongoing treatments and how effective they have been in giving lifespan to patients with autoimmune disease. When I began some 60 years ago in this field, if we had a patient with a diagnosis of lupus, that was a 5-year death sentence. She would be dead in 5 years, very likely. Certainly that's not true today. We've seen a remarkable extension of life, and a remarkable improvement in quality of life in diseases like lupus, like multiple sclerosis, and so on. But if we think of the future, as we might from the earlier discussions on the Affordable Care Act, we realize that the cost of treatment is unsustainable, that as autoimmune diseases increase, extending life is of enormous benefit to the individuals, but if we're going to afford that level of treatment as a nation, we need to begin to, as they say, bend the curve. And that means, to me, the future in autoimmune disease is not just to arrest the disease, and I think we've made great progress in that, but to cure the disease. And we have, so far, had no success. And more important, to prevent the disease. So we need to know more about the basis of the disease and where we can effectively treat the disease. And we need, and we've heard a great deal about this from Dr. Sommer, of we need to understand more of who has the disease and who's going to get the disease. And the next step in autoimmune disease in the next 25 years will be a renewed effort to prevent autoimmune disease. And I'd love to be here for the next 25-year meeting to say that the problem is solved and we can all go home. Well, I have one little point to start with. And that's a pet peeve of mine. In addition to research, I have also, during my career, been a practicing pathologist and responsible for a clinical laboratory. And one of my pet peeves is what I call the tyranny of the threshold. What do I mean? Well, we report data to physicians, onward now to patients, on the basis of difference from a control population. And we report it as normal or abnormal. And there's always a little, if you see these reports, you see a little flag that say this is an abnormal value. That isn't true. That is not true. That's not the way nature works. That's not the way biology works. It is not a two-sided dichotomous function. These are all continuous functions. Everybody has autoimmunity, and everybody has a risk of autoimmune disease. And the question is, not only do you have it, can we treat with it, but what is the likelihood that this disease will occur or that disease will occur? And so my favorite prediction is that we're going to begin to assign risk numbers with data that will allow us to determine what is the possibility, the likelihood that a disease is going to occur. So a great deal of the future depends upon our ability to acquire and to analyze and to understand large amounts of data. So to start our look into the future, I'm going to ask Ben Larman to tell us how we can handle big data.
Thank you, Dr. Rose. Just to introduce myself, I'm in the pathology department at Johns Hopkins in the immunology division. And my background is in physics and engineering, and that's the background that I bring to the study of autoimmune disease. And my laboratory is primarily focused on the development of technologies, highly multiplexed technologies that can monitor immune responses. And what we really try to do is identify what the immune system is recognizing, whether it's an active infection or a target tissue in an autoimmune disease. And we generate large amounts of data in an effort to identify new triggers, drivers, and associations between the targets of immune responses and autoimmune diseases. And so Dr. Rose asked me to think about the future, and I think as a segue to that, I just wanted to opine about how I see a paradigm shift happening right now, and that is that in not only my laboratory, but many across the world are developing these highly multiplex technologies, and that means our ability to take many, many measurements of the immune system at its current state, as well as looking at what the immune system has seen in the past, so an integration of exposures. And so I think that you know, we're all familiar with the term omics, and this has really been a driver of this paradigm shift, going from single measurements to highly dimensional, high-dimensional measurements. And this is in the fields of genomics, proteomics, metabolomics, single-cell biology, and along with sort of the wet bench technologies that are being developed, the second part of sort of these three pieces that fit together for this paradigm shift, I see advances in statistical approaches, so computational methods that can handle the output of data from these new technologies. And the third component of this paradigm shift I see is on the clinical side, and that's assembling highly phenotyped cohorts of individuals that probably share the etiologies that drive their disease. And we just heard about ARNet, and I think that's a fantastic example because it's, as we heard, so important to work collaboratively across institutions, across countries, to identify and work with individuals with rare diseases. And so where do I think this will all go? Well, we have a very poor understanding, I think, of how autoimmune diseases work at this time. We don't know what triggers most diseases, what proteins the immune system is trying to recognize and eliminate mistakenly in our bodies. And so I think that there's a huge opportunity to identify these new etiologies. And as that starts to happen, I think that we will also be in parallel developing ways to tolerize our immune systems. Once we know what the immune system is going after, and if we're able to in parallel develop ways to tolerize the immune system to those things, then we can start talking about cures for autoimmune diseases and preventions too. If there is a certain viral trigger for people of a specific genetic background, then those, you know, that maybe can increase the priority to develop a vaccine for that specific virus and be provided to people of that specific genetic background. So that's sort of how I envision the future in terms of cures and prevention based on high dimensional measurements of people's immune systems.
Okay, and are you going to be able to tell me when I see a patient that the likelihood that you will, that if you have one autoimmune disease, you you may have another, or are you going to be able to give me numbers on that?
Well, so I think, as you know, an important component of the immune system is its stochasticness, its randomness. And so I think it may be very difficult, even if we know someone's complete genome and their viral exposure history, to know for sure whether they're going to develop an autoimmune disease, because there's a roll of the dice that the immune system relies on in order to recognize anything that it comes across. So I think it may be impossible in theory to predict exactly who will get what. But I think, you know, we already know there are genetic backgrounds that are more susceptible to autoimmune diseases. And I guess to answer your question, the more we know, the better we can predict, but I don't think we'll ever, and so you may end up with a percentage, like you say, but never an absolute.
All right, then let me call on the next panelist. Bill Eaton is interested precisely in that kind of question and very similar questions, I might say, in introducing him, although he has been chairman of a department of mental health. He's really an epidemiologist, but he calls himself a sociologist. So he'll have to defend that too. But can you answer my question?
I will answer the question in a second. And I was trained as a sociologist, so I think if I can just say that that gives me the most exalted and convincing claim for ignorance in the room. But I'll still try to do something useful. So I got into this because I'm interested in schizophrenia. Back in 1969, that's all we knew about schizophrenia, social class. Now the question is schizophrenia an autoimmune disease? That's an interesting question. For more than 50 years, 60 years actually, we've known that people with schizophrenia do not get rheumatoid arthritis. Their risk is 1/5 or 1/4. There are dozens of studies showing that. It's not because of neuroleptic protection, because several of the studies were before the era of neuroleptics. It's not because of less activity in the hospital ward, because there's plenty of studies of outpatients. It's not because of people with schizophrenia are less likely to report pain, because many of the studies are based on X-ray diagnosis. So this is something we still are puzzling. There are just starting to be studies of interleukins differences between schizophrenia and the general population, but that's an unresolved question even after 60 years. The other thing is that schizophrenia, there's higher risk for schizophrenia if you have celiac disease or non-celiac gluten sensitivity. And this we've known for, again, 60 years. There are case studies of people who have had schizophrenia for 10 years. They've had brain measures of hyperfrontality. Then the psychiatrist discovers that they, that they have celiac disease, and says, let's pull them off wheat. 2 weeks later, the gastrointestinal tract is recovering, and 6 weeks later, they don't have any symptoms of schizophrenia, and they're off neuroleptics. I mean, they're flat dead cured in these case studies, and the hyperfrontality is gone. So case studies are not everything. There are about a half dozen, maybe 8 clinical trials, some successful, some not, and we think the reason that some are not is because only a fraction of the people with schizophrenia have the risk involving celiac disease. And I want to comment on the RNET, because I've worked getting out in graduate school. I discovered that if you want to do epidemiologic studies of schizophrenia, you could not do that in the United States, the great United States. You have to go to Denmark or Sweden or Finland, where they have case registers. And the Denmark case register compares to RNET in it's a complementary system. There are 6 million people in Denmark. You can follow them for 20 years. You can generate 100 million person years of exposure for a given risk factor. They've been getting the Guthrie card since 1981, so they have the genome of every single individual born after 1981. and they have the clinical diagnosis of everybody who's been to a specialty clinic or a hospital. And there are no areas of Denmark more than 30 miles away from a clinic. So, and here, healthcare is free, so that's another advantage. And that applied that issue to celiac disease and schizophrenia. We found out that a history of celiac disease in the family or the individual was associated with 2.7 times risk for future schizophrenia, not a trivial amount. And then we decided, well, let's look at the other autoimmune diseases. And there are a half dozen or a dozen autoimmune diseases that predict in the family or in the individual that predict enhanced risk for schizophrenia. If you add them all up, any of 30 that we studied autoimmune disease, they raise the risk for schizophrenia by 45%. An occurrence of any one of those 30 autoimmune diseases raises risk by 45%. even controlling for social class of background and urban ethnicity of birth and family history of schizophrenia. So it's an independent. So that got us into autoimmune comorbidity. And this is something that Emily Summers was talking a little bit about. We have discovered that there is fantastically strong case comorbidity. I think everybody knows this, but we have the data on it from Denmark. So we have 30 autoimmune diseases. We can estimate the correlation or the relative odds of each of those autoimmune diseases with each other. That's 465 correlations or odds ratios. And there are none of those odds ratios that are below run, and more than 100 are greater than 3. And about 50 are greater than 5. So when you look at that data on comorbidity, you're an epidemiologist, it's like, I don't know if there's a German speaker, Schlaraffenland. It's Schlaraffenland. The Germans use Schlaraffenland like we do Big Rock Candy Mountain, where you go into Schlaraffenland and the pigs are already cooked and they have knives and forks stuck in their back and the rivers run with beer and there's wine pouring out. You know, it's something we haven't exploited yet, but it seems to me it's terribly important. The autoimmune diseases are terribly comorbid. And this comorbidity has an unusual shape to it. For the cases, an individual, the comorbidity is very strong. That's what I just described. More than everything is related to everything, just about. And not trivially, in an odds ratio of 10 or 12 or 15 or 20 sometimes. However, the family comorbidity, so parents to offspring or sib to sib, is nowhere near that strong. It's nothing compared to that. In fact, it's localized right into the individual diseases. So one disease doesn't predict another. It predicts itself in the offspring or itself in the sib with a very strong prediction. And another little interesting factor is that the sib-to-sib ratio is always stronger than the parent-to-offspring ratio. So what that suggests is, number one, there's a genetic background for autoimmune diseases, and it's related to schizophrenia. But there is also a strong environmental component. Something is producing the higher sib-to-sib ratio than the parent-to-offspring ratio. So, you know, we've been worried about rare diseases. The Danish registry can take care of the rare diseases because they have 6 million people. And it's, you know, and they don't have thresholds, so they're using diagnoses. That's a disadvantage. And they can't approach the individuals like RNET. Strikes me it's a complementary arrangement. But we can do very important analytics. And we have, like I say, the genome of every individual since 1981. And if they go and get the sera taken, we have the results of the sera test, too. So those are ideas I've had. And now I want to just read you the latest theory of schizophrenia. You won't believe it, but I'm going to read it word for word. Some schizophrenia psychoses are the result of damage to the microvascular system in the brain initiated by genetically influenced abnormal inflammatory processes acting in response to ubiquitous environmental factors that trigger inflammatory responses, including infection, trauma, or hypoxia. That's the simple version of this theory. But what I sense from this meeting is that this idea of big data, we have big data from RNET, big data complementary from a place like Denmark or Sweden. We have to get rid of our disciplinary lines. I would go to the psychiatrist with the data on rheumatoid arthritis and say, what's going on here? And the psychiatrist say, well, you have to talk to a rheumatologist about that. So I would take the same data and wave it across into a rheumatologist. And this is Mary Betty Stevens, if you remember her. And she says, well, I'm not a psychiatrist. So to make progress, we have to break down our disciplinary lines, and also we have to break down our specialty walls. And we have to then expand our study of the brain and the laboratory. So it is big data, like you were saying, except it's really big. But I think that's what the future holds for. And we have the technology to do that now, I think.
Okay, well, let's see what the implications are. Then these diseases seem to co-occur, if we can believe your data. And I hope that Ben is going to do all the analyses to confirm it all.
You're a co-author on that paper, Noel.
So if that's true, then the consequence is there must be some basic commonalities. Well, what commonalities do we know about? Well, we know that these responses are involved in the process of inflammation, at least in inducing the reaction. They may or may not be inflammatory in their final outcome, but certainly they are in the takeoff, if not the crash landing in every case. And the heart of understanding the inflammatory process are the mediators of inflammation, which we call the cytokines. They're getting a lot of press these days, but we really need to begin to, and rightly so, but we really need to understand how these mediators actually work and why they result in so many different outcomes, why the diseases are so different. So now we need people who will study in a serious way the way in which these processes that begin as inflammatory to take different pathways. And Mark Zielinski from the Harvard Medical School is going to tell us, but you're going to interrupt me?
Yes, I want to interrupt a little bit just to expand about, just to give you a feeling for, so for celiac disease and schizophrenia, prehaptoglobin 2 gene is a candidate gene discovered independently for schizophrenia, but then it was discovered it produced a protein called zonulin. Zonulin is a protein that opens up the intestinal membrane and let through all kinds of different wheat peptides, which get broken up, and some of those wheat peptides can transmit through the blood-brain barrier, and there can be an immune reaction to those. So. And there are inflammatory cytokines which mediate that process in some ways, too. So it's just an example of the direction that we're going.
Okay. Sorry. Okay. Mark, tell us a little bit about how cytokines can produce so many different results.
Thank you. So cytokines do have so many results, and it's a good thing to know that, and it's a bad thing. Cytokines in general are involved with cognition. One of my main focuses is sleep, mood, anxiety, fatigue is a major one, sleepiness. So the question is, if they're involved in all of these things, how do you really target it? And that's the real issue of this question with particular pathologies. So I'll begin with a little bit about what I've recently found with my colleagues. And what we found was an interesting mechanism that induces these pro-inflammatory cytokines within the brain. This was not just a recent finding, but this was a building on many years of research. Over 100 years ago, the first research started where people sleep-deprived dogs and injected cerebral spinal fluid into non-sleep-deprived dogs, and they slept a lot more. So the idea was there's something in the brain, something in the body that's causing this. They later purified this, and they found that it was an immune-related molecule that's found on bacterial walls. And that led to more studies that indicated that interleukin-1 beta, which you've heard previously, was involved in this sleep response. Now, later studies found that as I said before, that interleukin-1 beta and inflammatory molecules do alter all of these other functions. So why is this important to autoimmune diseases? Well, people with autoimmune diseases and related diseases as well have increased incidence of sleep disorders. They also have some difficulties in some of these other behaviors, including fatigue. What was the particular mechanism that I recently found was something called the NLRP3 inflammasome. So what this is it's a molecule, a protein complex actually, that can recognize particular ambiguities and in changes that occur in the local environment. So some of these things can be changes that occur through metabolism, through energy-related molecules. And these also different pathogens and viruses, bacteria. Now this pathway is really interesting because there's two components that happen to it. And not to lose everybody's interest here with this difficult mechanism, but one of the things is there's a priming step that's needed. And this priming step is triggered by your bacteria or pathogens through their receptors, as well as inflammatory cytokines through their receptors, including TNF, tumor necrosis factor alpha, which our previous speakers showed was involved in many autoimmune related disorders as well. So there's a priming step, and then there's this activation step, and it triggers this protein complex to activate amongst inflammatory cytokines, interleukin-1 beta. And we found that that's a critical step in inducing sleep and electrical brain activity in a particular frequency range that's known to be restorative in sleep. So in short here, what I'm the importance of this is if you have a condition where you have inflammation in the brain or even inflammation in the periphery, it could stimulate this system and it can perhaps alter the progression of a pathology, or it could even trigger an autoimmune disease itself. I'm trying to be trepidatious here because this is very new. We just published this within a month, and there's so much more research that needs to be done. Back to what Dr. Eaton was saying about the blood-brain barrier, we have found in the past that there are, in general, the brain protects itself. It has this blood-brain barrier around blood vessels that prevent different inflammatory molecules and substances to enter the brain. But there are leaky areas. We've found that inflammation in the periphery can also, not just through the blood-brain barrier, but through the vagal afferent nerves, stimulate the brain and then alter inflammation as well. So there's a definite link between conditions that have peripheral inflammation, not just central nervous system inflammation, and this interaction perhaps could be really affecting not just the cause of the disease, but symptoms that can be debilitating. I often have people call me up, especially recently with some press we've received, and they say, you know, they have all these bad sleep problems, and they want some help. And it's not just they can't sleep, but there's very life debilitating impacts that they have on relationships, jobs, just ability with their mood, and their health. And now we're really at a groundbreaking time in science and neuroscience. There are lots of technologies that are involved that have been developed, such as optogenetics, where you can use lasers to specifically target and activate cells in the body. There's much more efficient and cheaper, faster ways to edit genes with CRISPR technology. And now there are even microendoscopes, which are kind of like putting a two-photon microscope directly onto an animal's head. And now you can look at in vivo mechanisms of things. So you can really investigate mechanisms that you haven't before. So there's really a lot to be gained with some basic research in the autoimmune and related disease area. And you know, schizophrenia is another exciting area. Just a few years ago, interleukin 1 beta was found to have to potentially involve interleukin 1 beta. But unfortunately, there's really no research out there in the basic field. And one thing I will say back to the Dr. Rose's original comment here was that, or question was that it does affect many things. And how do you target that? And how you can target that are, there are different regions in the body that react differently, especially in the brain. If you, let's say, give an animal a bacterial related component, the route of administration matters, the type of pathogen matters, the activity of the animal matters. All of these things influence the body, and it becomes very complex, but the specificity becomes the particular cells, the particular area of the brain or the body, and all of these things can be affected by behavior as well. So you can understand the genetics, and the genetics are extremely important, but lots of these behavioral and what happens to a person in their life is likely to influence the development of particular disorders and their pathologies. So that's what I have there.
Well, let me put it to you. A few years ago, ARDA did a poll of patients with autoimmune disease, asking what they found to be the first symptoms, or at least the most prominent symptoms, and it was fatigue, inordinate fatigue, not just tired, but exhaustion. So does your research help us, or can it help us in the next 25 years to understand why that's a common feature of many different kinds of autoimmune disease?
Well, I hope so. we'll have to see. Only the time will tell. But there's definitely a lot of information in the literature, and some of my work with exercise fatigue also shows that interleukin 1 beta is important. Now, one of the things that is really not investigated so much is how IL-1 beta, what's the next step? What is it acting on? And when you come to fatigue, a big part of that is the brain. And that's really going to, so interleukin 1 beta is produced by a number of cells, from neurons to astrocytes to microglia, et cetera. So understanding which particular cells in which particular brain area will affect fatigue versus sleepiness, which are different, will hopefully happen soon.
Yeah. I've been around long enough to have called what is now IL-1 beta pyrogen, meaning a substance that produces a fever, a febrile response. So we've already known from way back in the 60s anyway that this product does affect the central nervous system in a very profound way. But I guess we need to circle back. We have only a few minutes, but Ben, is there anything that your big machines can rev up here to try to put together some of these elements so we can begin to get more insight into what we do to nip autoimmune disease in the bud? In other words, we're now treating patients, it's not a very pleasant way of putting it, we treat patients with autoimmune disease after the train wreck has occurred, after they've been sick to the point where there is irreversible damage. You know, the kidneys are shot, the heart's not functioning, the GI tract is misbehaving. And we can treat that disease and make them comfortable and they can survive, but we want to prevent the disease. You told us that you would help us find what is really the initiator of the disease. So where would we start? What would we do? And how can we use these big data to help us put our hands on what I really would like to call a benign intervention, something we can do to intervene not in a sick patient, not in a patient, but a sick person who is likely enough, based on solid evidence, to develop an autoimmune disease, something we can do that's not going to be harmful to him, but will really prevent the disease from progressing at all.
I think one area that humanity could really invest in is the development of screening technologies that take lots of measurements that are very cheap. And this is happening, but it can happen faster and be better to pick up people who show some early signs of an anomaly in their immune system. And then, you know, speaking towards treatment, I guess it would probably be very disease specific. You know, what are the proteins that are being recognized by the immune system that you need to sort of say, no, that's self, that's okay. And I do believe that's the direction we'll go. And that coupled with more comprehensive screening technologies, I think could make a significant impact. But I think the problem may get worse before it gets better, in the sense that we may, as we're gaining better insights into how our immune systems work and what is going wrong, find out that there's a lot of diseases that are actually have an autoimmune component that we don't appreciate now. And I think this is becoming more and more apparent for the neurological diseases, neurodegenerative diseases. So I think that, as that insight grows, maybe there will be more investment on the screening technologies and early treatments, as you suggest.
I want to make two points. One is, this is a sad thing about the demise of the National Children's Study, because we were taking measurements on children from conception forward, and I'm going to follow them through death, and it died. And that's just a tragedy for the country. That we can't do this kind of early screening. And the time lag is terribly important. In psychiatric disorders, it's not weeks like an infection or months or years, it's decades. The things happen over decades. So there's now evidence that the presence of herpes simplex 1 virus predicts to cognitive decline 30 or 40 or 50 years later. If we can, we're trying to show that now. If we can show that, that would mean that there would be an inoculation, a vaccination for herpes simplex virus at the age of 3, which would have an effect 50 or 60 or 70 years later. So it's a similar, it's not exactly autoimmune, but it's a similar time lag kind of thing.
Well, maybe that's a good note to end on. Let me just expand a little bit on it. There is, I think, the one place where at least the ones that I know of, where what you're asking is really being done. Finland. Finland is the country with the highest prevalence of autoimmune diseases generally, type 1 diabetes, lupus, long list. And they have a national health scheme. As they like to say, every child is followed from the womb to the tomb. Everybody goes to the National Health Service, so everybody's seen on a regular basis. All of these data are stored, and that's the kind of study that would be possible anywhere where there is a coordinated health system. We have. Maybe this gets back to the first discussion this morning. We probably have the worst possible health system. I mean, we may have the best health instruments, but the worst possible way of gaining the information from it. And that's the big loss we have. The amount of data that could be available from electronic medical records, being able to use a common payer so that we gather comparable information on different people, follow them through the different vicissitudes of life, and then begin to analyze these data are probably the most cost-effective thing we can do to try to alleviate the problem of autoimmune disease. So I think we've used up our half hour. Do we have a moment to ask for any audience questions? I see nodding of heads, so the floor is open for anyone. And you have a ready audience here, ready to answer your question. Go ahead.
Thank you. What a fantastic presentation. Thank you so much. It's just exactly the most important thing in that you all are getting together and combining your thoughts and insights. And thank you so much, Dr. Rose. And I know exactly what you mean. My husband is a pathologist, and we're always arguing about lab results, frankly, because we have a couple children with autoimmune diseases, and he has some too. So this is something that, in fact, I'm devoting my life to, and I'm running a nonprofit. So I wanted to ask you, Dr. Eaton, about the schizophrenia studies, because I only know of one that just tested 6 patients, after which time most improved after a gluten-free diet. So is there a new study in Denmark? Is that?
I think there are 8 clinical trials, and then we have done about 2 or 3 more small ones in the University of Maryland, and one we just completed. And if any of you are on the National Advisory Mental Health Council, I'd be glad to take you to dinner tonight, because it got a good priority score, and we're waiting to hear about funding for it. But those clinical, there are not quite a dozen, but there are 10 clinical trials. Singh and Kay was the one that just drove everybody crazy in 1976 because it was so convincing. But the problem is, if you select just people with schizophrenia, 70% of them may not be relevant to the trial. So by random sampling, if you have a trial of 10 people, there might be none for whom it's relevant because of the sampling. So you have to identify in advance through blood tests for gluten antibodies. You get those blood tests, you select those people for the trial. That's what we're doing. Did I answer the question?
Yes, thank you. So there are those studies currently in progress, and are they producing results yet, or?
Well, there's a review from 6 or 8 years ago by Amanda Kalajian and myself that reviews the gluten connection, it's called, and schizophrenia. But then there are a couple of studies by a woman named Jackson with myself as a co-author, smaller studies. And then we've just finished a trial of 18, and in those 18, you have to show that you have a mediator for it. And in the 18, the negative symptoms of schizophrenia went down markedly after a 5-week inpatient trial with no gluten. And compared to the same people in the same no gluten situation getting a shake with wheat in it. And the decline in negative symptoms had a correlation of 0.7 with the decline in IgG anti-gliadin antibodies. So we're very hopeful that we've identified a moderator, those antibodies, IgG antibodies, and they may get into the brain, for all we know. They may slip through the brain. That's the hopeful sign we're working on. Now, we got to get funding to do a powered trial. That was a pilot test.
What kind of funding is needed? And also, are you all worried about the...
$2.5 million. Go ahead.
Well, that's good to know. And over what period of time?
Well, so it's three or four years. The state of Maryland supports the inpatient costs. That saves the government $1 million, literally. But you have to put people in for... You have to screen thousands of people to find the people that are relevant to the trial. Then you have to persuade them to leave their job or their housing unit to spend 5 weeks in a mental hospital, which is not the attractive thing that you would think. And then you have to, if they want to take a walk on the grounds, you have to send a research assistant with them because they can walk down to the 7-Eleven and get some cheese crackers and screw the whole thing up. So, you know, it's expensive to run. There's a day-by-day monitoring of all the people in the trial, and their food has to be completely gluten-free, except for the shake of rice or the shake of wheat. And the shakes don't taste very good.
Okay, good.
Thank you very much. Appreciate your...
We better move
appreciate
on.
Appreciate you all very much.
Other points to be raised by the audience? Okay, if not, thank you for the privilege of being able to speculate before you, and I think it's been a very worthwhile day, and I'm looking forward to our keynote address. So thank you all very much.
Thank you to our panelists, and of course to Dr. Rose for his 50 years of service to the autoimmune disease space. We truly appreciate it. Thank you, Dr. Rose, again.